Turn with me to the Gospel of John, John 1:1, or you can look on the board for the lesson today. John 1:1 reads this way, "In the beginning was the Word was with God," and now we're going to look at, "And the Word was God." Good stuff. The Word was God. So the Word is Christ Himself. The Word is Christ Himself, first and foremost. It's not just the Scriptures. It's not just a book. It's not just something that you learn to quote. The Word, Christ is the Word. And we'll get into this very shortly. But there is a difference between the Word and the Scriptures. There's a difference between the Word and the Scriptures. You only truly begin to see Christ in the Scriptures or in the Word, because He is the Word. You understand what I'm saying? Because He is the Word, you're only going to truly begin to see Him in the Scriptures, because the Word is in the beginning. In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God. The Word was God. So there's no need looking around in the beginning for anything else other than God. But this is describing Him more particularly by calling Him the Word. You find that in the beginning, before creation, in the beginning was the Word. You find in the book of Revelation, when He comes back, written upon His vesture is the Word of God. You begin to know that as the Word, the complete thought and concept of God, the Logos, that He is the beginning and the end. That the Word is not just something that's happening in time, but He was the Word before the beginning, and when it's all wrapped up, He's still the Word. But this is one aspect of the eternal God. Eternal God. The eternal God. Not just because if you think about in terms of salvation took place within a time frame. When you're in heaven, after it's all done, you're not going to need salvation anymore. Healing is something that took place within a time frame. Once you're in heaven, there will be no more need for healing because there will be no more pain, this sort of thing. So you won't know Him and relate to Him as healer. All the things, many of the relationships that we have built with the Lord, we have built with Him on temporal dealings based on temporal needs. All on a linear line between eternity past and eternity, end of eternity, or the end of time. Then we move into knowing God as the eternal God. Well, how many of us know Him as the eternal God? First of all, we don't, most of us don't know Him in His relationships properly, even Savior. I mean, you start talking about justification, reconciliation, redemption, salvation, all the different aspects, and we can't, you know, you just start hitting different people in class. What is this? What is this? What is this? What is the truth of this? What does the meaning reconciliation bring out? What does justification bring out as opposed to salvation? What does, redemption bring out? You know, that's even a temporal thing. We ought to at least know that. But we're talking about stepping into the eternal God, knowing the eternal God, you know, and to know Him as the Word is one of those aspects. So we discussed last class. Paul said in Galatians 1, "I marvel that you are so soon removed from Him unto another gospel," which he goes on to say, which is not the gospel, but. And he describes the gospel as a hymn. A hymn. "I marvel that you are removed from Him." Do you know that there are some people that have never really, really met Him? They've met the gospel message. But they don't know Him. They know the message. They know what the message is. They have believed the message, but they have not really met the one who is the fullness of that message. So if you leave the Word, you are removed from him who is the Word. Because he is the Word. The Word was God. You be removed from the Word, you're removed from him. Him, H-I-M. You see? We said, no, no, I mean, there's a whole lot of stuff in Christianity, you know, that I can be involved in. But we come to the Scriptures to know the Word. The Holy Spirit wants to reveal Christ through the Scripture. How's that read up in the Romans, probably a good place. It says, let me just read this. You don't have to turn that. Probably good to listen. This is Paul writing, now to him, this gotta love it, you know, the guy is Christ-centered. He's the person of Christ. So now to him that is of power to establish you, which we need to be established. Well, I'm saying, what's the big deal? He has the power to establish. Being saved is not enough. We need to be established. Now to him, not now to you, he is that, but now to him. See what I mean? He is Christ-centered. Now to him who is, that is of power to establish you according, because this is, you're going to be established, but it's according to something. It's not just, oh, randomly, somehow if I continue as a Christian, I'll be established. That don't happen. It is according to certain things. According to my gospel, Paul calls it. Why would he do that? Because he's identified with it. And the preaching of Jesus Christ, which is according to the revelation of the mystery, which was kept secret since the world began, but now is made manifest, and by the Scriptures of the prophets, according to the commandment of the everlasting God, made known to all nations for the obedience of faith. Didn't say obedience the way we always put it. We're obedient, but we ignore faith. Yeah. We need to be, and in fact, if you'd like to do a little search on it, the Word has a lot to say about the obedience of faith. Not just obedience. We're always running after that obedience thing. But, and then we skip being obedient to faith. And then a nice little ending. To God only wise. That means a lot to me, you know, because that means he's the only one that's wise. The only one. In Corinthians, he said that God has hidden this gospel from the wise and the prudent. God is the only one wise. I'm in him. And he has made unto me wisdom. If he's made unto me wisdom, that doesn't make me wise. That makes him my wisdom. Which where is the focus of the glory? God made me wise. Or Christ is my wisdom. He has made unto me wisdom. To the only wise God. To the only, I like that word, only. But we say, oh, Jesus, you're worthy. How about this? Oh, you're the only one. That has a whole different connotation. Oh, you're worthy. Yeah. So is General Motors. Because they hand me a check every week. You know what I mean? I mean, no. Only. You're the only one that's worthy. You know, and isn't it funny when during Great Worship we said, you're the only one that's worthy. You know, and then we mess up and we go, oh, I feel so unworthy. I wonder why. I mean, has it ever dawned on you why you would feel unworthy? Because you are, and he's the only one that's worthy. But we have, once again, not identified with Christ. We have gone about, as Paul said, gone about to establish our own. Key words right there. It shows it's not emanating from Christ, who is not self-centered, but self-giving. We have gone about, you have gone about to establish, or we have gone about to establish our own righteousness and have not submitted ourselves, brought ourselves under in obedience to the righteousness of God. Not obeying it, but submitted to it. The righteousness of God. That you know, and this is why Paul started out in Corinthians, and he said, you know, preaching of the cross is foolishness because through the cross, God has chosen the base things, the foolish things, and the outcasts, and the this and that, and the flakes and everything, because they will come to him and say, I can't do it, or I can't be it, I'm not good enough, I'm not wise enough, I'm not, he says, and he hasn't chosen the wise and the noble and the outstanding and the good, I mean, not many, he said, not many wise, not many noble, not many, but, and he says, because Christ, but of God, are you in Christ, and in him, Jesus has made unto you wisdom, righteousness, sanctification, and redemption with one purpose, so that he that glorieth, let him glory in the Lord. So we forget that Christ is these things. We get wise. We get righteous. We do. And then we glory in what we've accomplished, who we are, the reputation that we have built. And we've left him. Paul said, I'm marveling how soon you are removed from Israel. It is, you know, because to Paul, now I mean let's try to get inside the mind of his brother. He had so seen the Lord that Christ was, I mean, listen to his words. I mean, this is not just, we got to remember, he's not like us. He really meant this stuff when he saw it, you know. He is the length and the breadth and the height and the depth. You can get it by, just reading the way that he, responds. Oh, the depths of both the wisdom and knowledge of God. How unsearchable are his judgment and his ways past finding out. Who hath known the mind of the Lord? Who hath been his counselor? Who hath first given to him and shall be recompensed unto him again? For of him and through him and to him are all things, to whom be glory forever and ever. This isn't some guy riding from prison going, I'll flower this up a bit. This guy is overwhelmed. He's swamped. He's in a boat, a little rowboat in the middle of the Pacific Ocean, and a storm has come over and swamped his boat, and he's in the huge vastness of Jesus Christ. And so he, from there, he writes. We go, God is good. You know, God did something good for me today. You know what I mean? This man has totally been seen the reality of Christ. So for him, it's no big deal for him to say, look, I marvel that you would be removed from this vastness, this fullness, this, the only wise God, the only one worthy, the only, the one, the, you know what I mean? I mean, you listen to his words, from whom, the one from whom, and to whom, from and to, and, and so he looks at them and he goes, why would you be removed from him? Unto, later on in Galatians, he calls it beggarly elements. Beggarly elements. You picture the Father and the Son sitting at the table provided through the provisions of Jesus Christ with all provisions at the feast of the Lord, of the Lamb. You picture all of the provision there with their presence and everything. And the Father with his Son desiring to fellowship and to partake together of all that has been provided, and the kids are on the floor fighting over crumbs and growling at each other and pulling at each other down there on the floor over the beggarly little elements. And he says, come and die. Come and die. I marvel. Can you imagine viewing that and Paul going, I marvel that you you were so soon removed from him unto this, this mentality, this way from you have found a way and you've left the way. You have embraced some truths that you feel have made you something. You've left the truth. You have gone about to live a life for God. You left the life. You don't know that you couldn't, you know, that's why I would think he would say, you know, I would not have you ignorant, brethren. Know ye not. I mean, he's always, that's his approach. Listen to his words all the time. Know ye not, brethren. I would not have you ignorant. Seeing then that we have this ministry, we find out, I mean, he's always trying to get them to see it, because if they could see it. But, you know, I pray that the eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that you may know what is the hope of his calling, what is the exceeding greatness of his power towards us who believe, what is the length and the breadth, I mean, the height and the depth, that you may know this. And they're going, I'm saved. You know, Jesus said, this is what I shared on Sunday, Jesus said in John 8:31, he said, if you continue in my word, you know, and then said Jesus unto those that believe, if you continue in my word, you shall know the truth, and the truth will make you free. Their response is, what are you saying, we're not free? This was their response. What are you saying? We're not free? Hey, we're free. We're the seed of Abraham. We're Christians. We're followers of God. We know God. I mean, we go to the temple all the time. We're involved in this stuff. I've heard all about God ever since I was little. I know all about God. What are you talking about, Jesus? How dare you say this? Jesus ends up, I mean, he wasn't trying to attack him, but he ends up saying, you are of your father the devil. The works of your father you will do. The words that he speaks you will speak. Because you are of his seed. You don't know. And if you were not of his seed, if you were of my father's seed, then you would not go about to kill me. Who is? We find out later Paul calls him the Prince of Life. He came unto his own, and his own received him not. And so, the Word was God. Glory to God, the Word is not just with God. We talked about with yesterday. And we saw the greatness of with. We saw the vastness. We saw what it means to be with. Was. He not just with. The Word is with God because the Word loves God. Praise God. He is one. He is just as we are one, bone of his bone, flesh of his flesh, he that is joined to the Lord is one spirit. Then why get under the table scratching and biting over the crumbs that fall from the table? Why act like animals instead of the sons of the living God? We see the best of the followers of Jesus in one family that followed him in his life. And we see the best traits. I believe the top traits that you can see in this family towards Jesus. The oldest, I assume the oldest, the male child was a man named Lazarus. His next youngest sister was a woman, I don't know what the order was, my assumption is, Martha and then Mary. This was a family in Bethany that had they had Jesus there. You search the scriptures, you find that Jesus spent a lot of time in their house. He came to their home. I believe that he found a kindred spirit. I believe that he found things that drew him to one another. I believe he found openness, desire, and hunger. I believe he found many, many different things. And the Bible says clearly of even of Martha, and Jesus loved Martha. You know, Martha, Mary, and Lazarus. And we always, you know, of course we're comparing thing, and we're into, you know, because we want to be the best. Comparing really is the best way to go, you know, compare, find out what's the best, know the best, you know. And then we're going to be the best. And this is another way that we go about to establish our own righteousness. But in reality, Mary wasn't, if you really were going to start talking good, better, best, Lazarus was the one. And you check it, the different positions that they took. Martha served. She was busy, she was ministering, she's always doing, and she's doing for the Lord. I truly believe that she was doing for the Lord. I believe her heart was right. And Jesus loved her. As much as she knew her heart was right, she wanted to serve the Lord. And I believe when she went about to do that she gave it her best. Okay? But you know what? You can give it your best and get bogged down, get behind, or not be able to accomplish what you wanted to for the Lord and get upset with everybody else because they're not helping you. Right? Was Martha of God?
Amen.
Martha loved God?
Yes.
Was her goals righteous?
Yes.
Did she get off?
Yes.
Great. Finish the three positions. Martha served. We have several examples of this in the scriptures. Mary sat at Jesus' feet and heard his word. But Lazarus sat at the table of Jesus. And I believe that's a place of fellowship, a place of supping, of partaking of. Some of the best moments my family has at the house are at the table to eat. The big culmination of the gathering in heaven is called the marriage supper of the Lamb. Lazarus didn't just sit down at his feet and look over and go, don't misunderstand me. I believe there's actually a progression. I believe that we can be Martha, Mary, and Lazarus, and then eventually one with Christ. We go. So that you're identifying Jesus, not the other. But I believe there's many times a progression of serving, then sitting at his feet and hearing his word, which is necessary. But then, folks, there comes a time when you get filled up that you can sit down and fellowship with the Lord. You can sit down and fellowship with any brother. I mean, I remember, you know, when I was in Bible school, there were three or four different people that I just, when they shared the word, it just wowed me. But I also remember many years later, as I began to grow, as a matter of fact, for almost all of those, but one, I became their pastor. But to be able to sit down and open the word and share Christ, because now it's no longer me saying, share Christ, or me ministering in the body under their direction, maybe still all of that, but for sure with them, to sit down and they share something, and I can share, and we both, it's like handing each other food. It's like feeding each other, so that we both walk away and go, praise God. You know? And I believe that that's what Lazarus represents, the position that he had been put. Now, once again, ultimately, we're going to be identified in Christ. One way, as long as it is possible, we're in Christ. Because even the fellowship thing can get off, too. I mean, you know, the serving to the just hearing his word. I know people that sit at Jesus' feet, and that's all they've done for the last 20 years, and never done anything else. Okay? You know, ever learning, never able to come to the knowledge of the truth. There comes a time when you must progress. There comes a time when you move from here to this next stage, then you move from there to this next stage, then this stage, and then you're in Christ. I mean, as much as identifying can bring you, you don't look and see, well, where am I in this? You look at Jesus and say, I know right where I'm at. I'm in Christ. Because the Word declares. And I'm one with the Word. The Word was God. Yeah. I didn't get past three sentences. We can finish it. There's better than this. If you worship in the Word, I chose to word this way. If you worship in the Word, you find strength and direction there. You find strength and direction there, for it is the place that you see Christ. Was not in the beginning, but the Word was. kind of one of the reasons for sharing this part is that, you know, there are some people who just, you know, this is the word of God. You know, I mean, you know, you take your Bible, throw it down, then walk out. How dare you treat the word of God that way? You know, I came to Bible school and I was just busy. There was a swing set. I ran over there. I wanted to swing. A couple of other students that were in class. I ran over there. I threw my Bible on the ground, and one of them said, "How could you treat the word of God that way?" I said, "That's just a book. That's a book where we learn about God. That's not God." Well, there are people who don't want you writing your holy. It's called Holy Bible. That good book about Holy Bible. And there are people that will put so much emphasis on the scriptures that you're actually pointed away from the Lord too. Did you know that? You know, I believe that as much as you can be in the scriptures, if it'll work out, you should try to, as much as you can, you know, possibly as you know, of course, what I mean is in the Lord that you can be in the scriptures, you should. But with a heart to know the Lord. Not thinking, knowing all the scriptures is knowing the Lord. But knowing all the scriptures is preparing my heart so that the Holy Spirit has more room to deal and reveal Christ. You see what I'm saying? It's different. I mean, learn the scriptures, but don't think by learning all the scriptures, knowing all the order of everything, that that's the Lord. That's not the Lord. That's the scriptures. Now the Holy Spirit must come. You're laying a foundation of scripture so that when the Holy Spirit moves, He'll reveal Christ and you'll have. It's like I said, you know, you can play three notes on the guitar and learn to play them in about seven different orders. You know, ding, 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 or ding, 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 or ding, 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 or ding, ding. You know, you can change up the order, but you only know three notes, you know. Well, if you learn all the scales and you got all the notes within that key, then you can go, you can go anywhere you want. And more importantly, the Holy Spirit can take you anywhere that He wants. But if you're all limited, you know. But don't become a Pharisee by learning some things. Because if you see Jesus, you won't become a Pharisee. Because Paul was a Pharisee, he saw Jesus, and he no longer was a Pharisee. Right? So learn the scriptures with one intent. Search the scriptures with one intent, that I may see Jesus. If you don't see Him and you've learned some facts, thank the Lord that you've learned some things, and now ask the Lord, Lord, use this, Holy Spirit, use this to help reveal your Son. We must not see the scriptures given of God, but Christ. We have to see Christ. The Word is a person. The scriptures reveals a person. The Word is a person. The scriptures reveal that person. You can look at the scripture anytime you want, but you cannot see the Word unless the Holy Spirit reveals it. So, okay, I've heard people say, well, man, I get the Word, but I don't see anything. You can get in the scriptures anytime you want and lay this foundation. Work as hard as you want, as much as you want to lay a foundation, learning all the don'ts. You can't. You cannot open the scriptures to see Jesus. Remember the book of Revelation chapter 5? They handed Him a book. And everybody in heaven wept and said, nobody's able to open the book. Nobody, how are we going to understand it? How are we going to know what's in the book? How can our eyes be? And it says everybody in heaven was weeping and crying, and John was standing there, and John started weeping, you know. And a couple of angels were there, and John said, how are we going to know the book? Who can open the book? And that was the cry in heaven. Who can open the book? And one of the angels said, behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, He hath prevailed, and He can open it. And he turned to look, and when he looked, he didn't see a lion, he saw a little lamb on the throne. And the Lamb of God opens the book. The Lamb of God. see Christ as the Lamb, the Word, these are eternal aspects of it. Then the book begins to be opened and your eyes are open. Luke chapter 24, they're walking along with Jesus, but they don't know that it's Jesus. And they're talking and they're going, you know, Jesus says, what are y'all talking about? He says, we're talking about, we, if Jesus came and he died, we hoped that he'd have been the one. Boy, we were really hoping that he was, but he's dead. He's right there, raised, a resurrected Jesus standing right there. But they didn't see the resurrected Jesus. All they knew was the linear one from now to time. And so he began to share with them the scriptures. And it says, from the beginning of Moses all the way through the Psalms, right on through, he opened their understanding that they might understand him. And then he disappeared out of their sight. But before that, they sat down in the breaking of the bread. Bread is good, but it's not good till it's broken. You can't eat it till it's broken. In the cross, in the Lamb opens the book. When in the breaking of the bread, they recognized him. They saw Jesus. And so, it wasn't even just knowing the scriptures or having the scriptures shared with you, they said. Didn't our hearts burn within us as he began to open the scriptures? But they didn't really see him until the breaking of the bread. Behold, the Lamb of God. Behold, the Lamb of God. You can look at the scripture anytime you want, but you cannot see the Word. That's the Holy Spirit revealing. So I would suggest look at the scripture as much as you can. Because that is something you can do. The scripture is written of the Holy Spirit and set in order by the Spirit in such a way so as he might teach the word through the scriptures. Have you ever wondered at reading the scriptures, why isn't the scriptures like about just this thick and it just goes up and says, you just see Jesus, get in the word, go to the cross and die, and stay in the word. I mean, I have. And I wrestled for a good year, for sure. I mean, that whole year, I remember just going, what is the deal? Why do you got all this stuff and all this stuff? Why don't you just say it? Anyway. And the Holy Spirit let me know that it's a closed book. That if they that diligently seek him will find him. But it means you have to knock. You have to ask. You have to seek and you shall find. But if it was all just laid out there, you know, we'd read it and go, oh, I understand that. Okay, I got that. Thanks. You know. What else is there? But the Holy Spirit lays it out, and it is in an orderly way. The scriptures are very orderly. They really are. Amazingly orderly. That was one of the things that, as I began to see the order, I began to understand that God was a God of order, because God laid it in order. The more I began to see things the way the scriptures did it, I began to go, golly, he is so orderly. Unbelievably orderly. But we don't see that because we have our little life going on here that is not very orderly, and him that is always orderly, and every once in a while we move up and we get that and we get a little piece of stability. Then we go back to our little thing. If we can just get in him and travel, we will see that he is Alpha and Omega, beginning, he is the end, he is the all the fullness between, and as we proceed in him, we will grow up into him in all things who is the head. But see, we're trying to grow up into religion, denominationalism, ministry. We've chosen areas of growth that we have determined to grow in. We're not growing up into him. Just seeking to know him so that if the opportunity comes to speak when you share Christ. And when the opportunity comes to minister, when you minister Christ. What is that? I'm spending a lot of time in Romans today. I don't know about you guys, but I can't remember exactly where it is. It's maybe out there. The scripture that says, if any man minister, let him minister as of the oracles of God. Isn't that 14 or is it 14? I keep looking at it and seeing other steps. Okay. Anyway, it's in there and it says, if any man minister, let him minister as of the oracles of God. If any man does this or that, each thing, basically what it's saying is that if let it be Christ in everything that you do, so that if you get an opportunity to speak, don't be foolish. I had a situation arise recently where I got to hear several ministers speak, and one brother was so obvious that he wanted to seize this moment. He wanted to seize this moment. He wanted to get across what he was, what he believes, and he wanted to impact those people. He wanted them to know they were impacted because he ministered. And all that I'm saying, I am not critical, and I wasn't critical at the moment. I was other things, but I wasn't critical. And in fact, I think I love the brother more now than I did before that kind of thing, to be honest with you. But he wanted so bad. And I would assume that a lot of that was emanating from a heart that really loved God, loved the people of God. Really. I mean, I do not attribute bad motives. But it was because it was a moment in time, linearly speaking, that he had to seize. He had to take the bull by the horns. And he had to get their attention. And this had to be the whole ball of wax. He hit it with everything he could. And everybody else that had been sharing, it was very much like this. Well, you know, praise the Lord. You know, I tell you, the Lord's good. That's what I'm getting at. And then this one was like, the Lord is saying. You know, and it was like, ah! and volume is going to make the difference. And or something. I don't know how to do that. I'm not good at that. That kind of stuff, you know. I wouldn't make a good preacher. It's just preacherly oomph. That's what it is, right there. Preacherly oomph. That's okay. Well, never forget that. Preacherly oomph. Don't ever get it. Really. It immediately divided him from everybody in the crowd, though. That was not his goal. And it wasn't a bad spirit that did it. It was a real desire that he took into his hands how to accomplish that. And he saw the moment, and the window of opportunity hadn't been there maybe for a long time. So this was the way he approached it. Before I call on Greg, if you minister as much as you can, minister as of the oracles of God. If you minister as much as you can, let it be Christ. Be content to minister very little if all that you've got is a little bit of Christ. Be content with that. In small doses, release the Christ that you have and hold back and fast your strength. Don't release your strength. strengths and abilities. Paul said, what's gained to me, I count loss for Christ. Don't, you know, you're better off, and start that way. Get a good start. Here I am, Lord, if you can use me, if you get anything out of me, fine. If not, then I'm just, you know, probably not going to be very useful for a while. You know. To start that way is wonderful, because then you don't have to undo a bunch of stuff. I know what I'm talking about. Because when I started, like, bang! And it was very similar to that. So that in 1 year, I totally gave out, fell down at the base of the cross, and said, my God, I can't do it. Nothing on the earth, the old rowboat. The rowboat's going in front of you and everybody's swimming, you know. And I'm going, yeah, you know, we're going across the Pacific Ocean here, you know. And I get, you know, 1 mile at that, you know, half a mile into the ocean. I'm going, all over, save me, I'm drowning, man. No more strength, no more. And I gave it everything I could, you know. And then, boom, you know, and I'm freaking out, going, I have nothing, this is terrible. I have no ability, I have no strength, I'm totally useless to God. And that's when he picked me up and said, okay, boom, began to reveal his son in me, and I went, yes, and loved it, and grabbed it, and said, oh, this is it, this will be my strength. This will be my hope, this will be my life. And know that if I ever had to give up Christ, I would be nothing. I would be a heap of nothing. And I know that. And I truly know that. I really believe that I know that. I know it so much. Not that it scares me, but it makes me appreciate Jesus so much. That's what it does. It makes me appreciate the Lord so much. All the time. Daily. Recognize then all the situations that arise that are beyond me. Wisdom that's needed beyond me, the strength that's needed beyond me, the ministry, the just the fortitude sometimes, the physical fortitude. All these things constantly being put in situations where all you can do is you sense two things. I'm just going to give us a silly example. You sense this total weakness. It's like a point that if you touch, you just go like this, don't touch me. Am I weakness there, because I'm like a puppet that would cut the strings and just goes down. I have nothing, you know. But then there is that strength that is beyond strength. It is the strength of his life. It is Christ. It is nothing. It's not just Christ strengthening you. And I know the difference. I know the difference. You know, because sometimes he just has to strengthen me as a weak vessel. But there's nothing like the strength that is Christ. There's nothing like the strength that is Christ. There's nothing like it. Because it is endless. It is unconquerable. It is always available. It is you never get the sense that this is running out. You know. But it's like a really skinny wire plugged into a big old power supply that, and after a while you go, I don't know if I can handle this long. You know, sometimes it's almost like, you know, I tell people, sometimes I have to backslide just to go to sleep, you know. Oh, glory, you know what I mean? Oh, you know. I mean, it's like, you know, you really just have to,
If any man speak, let him speak as an oracle of God has been in the ministry of the Lord.
Yes, keep reading.
Okay. If any man speak, let him speak as an oracle of God. If any man minister, let him do so, do it as the ability, do it as the ability which God has given that God ultimately may be glorified in Jesus Christ, to whom be praise and dominion forever and ever.
My God, did you hear that scripture? Did you hear that? That'll change everything you do if you just really got it. I mean, it'll change your whole approach to ministry and speaking. That's the truth of God in a nutshell right there. If any man speak, if, now it's probably better you don't. Be slow to speak, swift to hear, but if. You got to understand if before you move to the next one. Any. Any. But I'm a great any. But I'm a trained speaker. Any. But I know what I'm talking about. Any. If any man speak, let. Didn't say do. Let is a yielding word, not a doing word. Let is a submission word, not an action word. Let him speak as the oracles of God, or the word of God. If any man minister, but I know what I'm doing. If any man minister, but I understand how the ins and outs of this particular ministry works. If any man minister, but I understand, you know, equipment. If any man minister, but I understand people and human. I don't care if any man minister. Let him do it as of the ability which God giveth. Continually supply through your prayers and the continual supply of the Spirit of Jesus Christ, Paul said. Through your prayers and the continuous supply of the Spirit of Jesus Christ, the ability which God giveth. When I use the terminology, it's not in the scriptures. Be plugged in. We messed that up for a long time. We don't understand. I'm talking about the ability which God giveth. I'm talking about the preaching of the cross is the power. The word power is dunamis. It is inherent power. Inherent, meaning all within itself sufficient power. It's from the word we get dynamite and dynamo. Dynamo is actually a better word because dynamite means a boom, bow, gone. Dynamo means this constant, inherent. Okay, let's turn on the lights. You light the city. The dynamo is running. Dunamis. The preaching of the cross is dunamis. It is dynamo. It is inherent. Well, we go, well, I think I'm on faith today. I want to talk to you about Jesus. Praise Jesus. You know, he died on the cross, and you need to die on the cross, too. I heard that somewhere, and I believe it. My spirit bore witness, and you shall too. I know if I raise my voice a little louder, this will make it, you will really receive this. You need God! Speak on, old dynamo. Paul said in another place, it is as sounding brass, tinkling cymbal. It is just a clamor. It is a clanging. It is an irritant. It is... that we could go with the scriptures. If any man speak, let him speak as of the word of God. You know what I mean? I mean, that's what you want to go. I'm just preaching. Could we look at a scripture together? And he says, if he speak, let it be the word of God. If he ministers, let it be. Not, if he speak, let it not be your words, but the word of God. If he ministers, let it not be your ability, but the ability which God giveth. Not just a temporary gift. And fine, I tried to give it, but that's not really his ultimate. kid comes and goes, and then you're back there, you know. Well, I'm weak, I can't do it, but I better do it. But if you speak, let it be His word. If you minister, let it be His strength. And here's why. Here's why. Not just, it's a good idea on where God wants to be in control of everything. I mean, after all, that God in all things may be glorified through Jesus Christ. If you minister, if Jesus is the word, you speak, I mean, Jesus is the word. And if you minister, Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. And when you minister the word, when you are speak the word, and when you minister through the life, God is glorified through Jesus Christ. And the goal is accomplished. Not what was accomplished in the ministry, not what was accomplished, because you will speak many times. It can be the word of God in power and get absolutely no results. None. Nobody hears, or they hear and they all say they hear, and they don't, and they never live according to it, or they just say, kill him, crucify him, or they say, I hate this guy. I mean, you know, because, again, I've pretty much been in the camp, you know, this guy must think he's something. You're going, just like Jesus said, the Father is everything. You go, well, you say you're something, because you say you're his son. You're his son. He's going, no, I'm not. I'm trying to glorify the Father. Oh, you make yourself something. He couldn't possibly, but that's what they say he did. Not even him. Read their motives into what's happening here, because it must be his way, because this is the way I think and act. So this must be nothing more than me. They missed Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God. And they not only missed him, they turned on him. That God may be glorified through Jesus Christ, that's not even all, to whom be praise and dominion forever and ever. And then he says, yes.
Well, this is bro. If any man needs to know any first, he said that Luke 9:23 came blind, and there it says any man. And basically any has to do with, you know, it's an unconditional thing of whoever. And then anytime, well, or at least most of the time the scripture speaks of men, it's talking about mankind. And just notice it, and go to the number real quick. God created mankind as the whole, you know, talking about men and women, not just, you know, a man, so to speak, one person. And it was interesting that the Lord was showing me that the vessels were created or designed to contain treasure, both give the idea of denying it. And both these scriptures, the vessel itself, which was created to contain the treasure, has to first deny itself, and then it has to conform to the Spirit. And both of those scriptures. If anyone can speak, he first has to deny himself, because you can't speak the word of God if yourself is there. And then the next step is you have to conform to the Spirit. And in Luke 9:23, if any man will come after me, he has to deny himself first, take his cross, have that something placed in him, and then follow me. Both those imply denial and looking for it, which is action.
I've seen that in I can't remember the Greek word for it, but there's two contrasting words, the contrast of the word empty and full. And empty is fitness or something like that, and also kenosis. And then fullness, I can't remember the Greek word either. But there's always this contrast, but is working together of emptiness and fullness. And we usually only see the contrast in fear being empty, because it's one or the other. But you must see the contrast, then you must see how they work in union together. Always, there is an empty. There cannot be fullness without empty. There cannot. And that's exactly what you were saying. That there has to be that self-giving and that pouring out. Then there is that receiving of the fullness, the ability that God gives.
Well, my final conclusion in all that was that, like, with words like with,
yes,
okay, those two words, any man, meaning, like I said, in general, I have a specific creation of God.
Okay, we're going to take a little break here. I do want to say this. You know, there's a difference between preaching and teaching. I've been doing a lot of preaching since we did this. I have no idea why. I really like teaching. You can always tell when you really start teaching because that's trouble. You know? But I've been doing a lot of preaching. I have no idea why I'm doing preaching, but I am. And I hope, you know, it is the Spirit of God and the way He's coming on here over here. And part of it is God is really, 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 really dealing with me in ways that I don't even understand. But it's just that in one way, maybe I feel like a caterpillar that has been in the cocoon that I am just trying to break out of this thing. And you just have to be the one, you know, when I let it fly, I didn't stand it, okay? So just hear what I have to say. And ask the Lord what is of Him and what's not of Him. You know, go on. Isn't there any weirdness in me or my style or my way or whatever? Just go, that's just the rest of it. I don't even think of those things a lot of times, but then I, you know, find myself giving weird examples or, you know, I'm not trying to do anything. I'm just trying to present the Lord, but it isn't His vessel. I am going to